Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to the first global Thesis Square event, Supply Chain Restart. My name is Mariuta Clinciu. I'm Head of Sales Thesis Square, and we invited you to have a conversation with experts, sales leaders, bring you the latest insights on market scenarios, and to rethink how to reboot supply chains. So this event is part of a webinar cycle that Thesis Square wanted to organize, and in order to have close to our customers and to be a one partner approach with our customers. So we have the honor today to have with us Mr. Fabio Sdogati, Professor of the International Economics of MIP, the University of Milan, Graduate School of Business. Good afternoon, Mr. Sdogati.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. Or good morning.
Or good morning, right. And we have Alberto Provervio, Associate Partner VPS, a Thesis Square company. So we have at our disposal an hour and a half, and within this time we'll have 15 minutes of questions and answers. So please feel free to send us your question during the session. So over the last months, people everywhere have been worrying about supply chain. Items have been out of stock at stores for weeks. Shortages in crucial categories such as packaged food, cleaning supplies, and more than that, medical safety equipment have been all over the news. At the same time, with store closed and the people staying home, the demand for other types of products has fallen. So my question for Mr. Sdogati, how will companies handle continued uncertainty and fluctuations in consumer demand?
Well, thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here myself today. I'll try and be interesting as far as I can. And I also try and be punctual. I'm setting my watch right now to respect the limits. Very quickly, my name, you know already, I'm Fabio Sdogati. I'm studying international economics ever since I was extremely young. I studied in the United States and in Europe. And over the last 14 years, I've been studying global crisis especially. Now, you see the title of my presentation, which of course, we have chosen carefully, uses a bunch of qualifiers about these demand-side shocks. Unprecedented, repeated, difficult to predict. Unprecedented is an adjective that's been used very much ever since February. And unprecedented means that nobody alive today is in the position of remembering the last pandemic. Repeated, this is possibly the most important adjective here. When I say repeated, what I mean to say is that this is not a once and for all shock. Anybody who thinks that we are facing a shock that, you know, we'll take care of and sooner or later we'll be out of it is misleading himself or herself. This is going to be an unprecedented, repeated over and over shock, and it is going to be difficult to predict because what we are facing here is the intertwining of health shocks, supply shocks, and predominantly demand shocks. So my focus today is on demand. How do you predict an unprecedented, repeated demand side shock? Very well, Mariuta, thank you. The background I'm setting for you is a long run background. You know, when you want to see how it is going to end, you better know how it all happens where? Well, my background today and for many years now is what we call the secular stagnation scenario. You see that in this graph, you have the growth rate of GDP ever since 1965. This is a five-year moving average, which we have chosen to smooth out the series. And you have a bunch of countries represented in the graph. So this is the growth rate of GDP year on year over the period 65 to 2018, five-year moving average. And, you know, the one thing that one sees immediately is that we started out growing real fast. All the countries were growing at the beginning of the period faster than they were growing at the end of the period. Those two vertical lines should help you, like they helped me, to identify periods. What I say is the first period, 65 onward, is about fast growth, but at a falling rate. The second period is stable growth at a decent rate. And then the last period is falling growth at with an average growth rate of only 1 point something. That is not so exciting. So please, let's keep in mind this scenario. This is not an economy that was growing like hell and employment was growing and income was growing and technological progress was everywhere. No, it was not so. This is a secular stagnation scenario. The expression in the current version is due to Larry Summers, a former Treasury Secretary of the United States. So secular stagnation. Now you move on to the next chart, and thank you, Mariuta. What you see is that now you have the background to ask yourselves, well, okay, Mr. Dogati, don't talk to me about 60 years in world history, talk to me about this crisis. Well, here is what's happening now. You see that there is an upward straight line. This upward straight line is drawn against time on the horizontal axis and rates of growth on the vertical axis. And you have a lighter second section of the line, which implies that that is what would have been growth for the world economy if we didn't have this shock. The shock happens where the green line meets the red one. With the red one, you have this tremendous drop. Now, for those of you who are not accustomed with this type of graph, this is very simple, really. You have the drop, red line. You have a slight bounce after the red line. And then you have two scenarios. You have a no second pandemic scenario and a yes, a second pandemic scenario. Why do I use this chart? Well, I use this chart because I have to justify my choice of words in the title. Unpredictable, better, difficult to predict demand. Why? Because this shock, we don't even know whether it's just a one hit from the health point of view or it is a two hit. Most everybody knows that over the last few days, there's been a return of the pandemic in Arizona, for instance, and people there are particularly worried. So there is a relationship between the strength of the health shock and the reaction by governments and the behavior by people. And all these things together, they will not rule out the possibility that just like in 1919, at the time of the Spanish flu, there will be a second hit. Now, if we have a second hit, we keep moving along the red line, and you see how much below the original projection line we would be. And if we are luckier and we have no second hit, then we'll move along something that appears to me as a blue line. You will forgive me. So uncertainty, this is it. This is it. It is not true that we have been hit by a meteorite and then this is it. The damage done, we have to start and recover. The scenario is very uncertain. Thank you, Mariuta. Now, according to the outlook you prefer, and of course, none of us has any idea about whether or not a two-hit scenario is more probable than a one-hit scenario, you have this outlooks for recessions throughout the world. We, in this chart, we only look at high per capita income countries. Then there will be a chart looking at lower high per capita income countries. When you look at this chart, which I don't see anymore, there it is, thank you. You see that the lighter red is the one hit scenario, the dark red is the two hit scenario. And of course, in the two hit scenario, the numbers of the recessions are terrible, are worse than the terrible numbers we have in the one hit scenario. Please keep in mind that these rates of degrowth of GDP, we have never seen, certainly we haven't seen even in the Great Recession 2008, 2010 in the United States, 2012 elsewhere, just like in Italy. Now, so I'm the CEO of this firm, and I'm listening to this guy, Mr. Dogati, who is telling me that the recession is in all high per capita income countries very, very, very fast and very, very, very deep. If, in addition, we expect a second hit, like is happening in China this moment, you know, you've read, right? You've read that in Beijing, they had a second outbreak, and in a matter of days, the authorities organized 350,000 tests for the people, and economic activity is being jeopardized again. So this is uncertainty. Now, when there is so much uncertainty, what do you do? Well, you react. That's what a CEO does, right? You value your options. You value the power of destruction that this recession can have on your firm and under different scenarios, and then you react. Now, this being the forecast, let me move on to the next slide. And very well. And what I see is that one of the big things that most people don't realize is that the one of the major outputs, major results of this crisis is shrinking spending, increased savings. People, ever since February, the world over, have begun saving more out of a given disposable income. Now, this is relevant for demand, right? This is relevant for demand because we know that in the most basic model, demand expenditure depends upon disposable income and propensity to save. Now, what these lines here are telling us is incredible. We haven't seen this before. Savings have increased a lot over the first 4 months of 2020 relative to the first 4 months of 2019 and relative to the average savings over the last 10 years. So this is not something simply 2019, 2020. This is something also 2020 relative to the average of the past 10 years. Households are saving more. Now, why should they save more? Because the hairdresser is shut down and they don't do any business. So I don't go, as you can see, to my hairdresser, and therefore I save. No, that's that's trivial. That's absolutely trivial. Of course, there is an element of that type, but the crucial point is households become parsimonious. They get, I'm using a big word, perhaps it's a bit exaggerated, but just to give you an idea, they get scared. Why? Because they see, obviously, that income is falling and unemployment is rising. And when I see around myself falling incomes, including my own, and rising unemployment, I know that nothing good can come out of that. So I start saving more. We call them precautionary savings. Of course, perhaps sooner or later we go back to the good old times when we were saving a lot, but when we were spending a lot, but savings nowadays is the word. So you see that what I have here is a very complex system to work out. It isn't easy, like it was in 2007. Hey, you know, in 2007 you had a few bankers, lots of bankers, who tried with this new financial instruments until it went well. Everything went well. When things started going bad, they went real bad. It was easy. It was economic. Here, it is not only economic. It is health shocks, repeated health shocks. It is demand side shocks, repeated demand side shocks. And it is supply side shocks that reinforce the difficulties of the economy. Well, good. So far, what I wanted was to give you an idea of the urgency of the situation. This is, I'm going to use a word that I don't use very often. This requires leadership. This is a situation in which leadership has to take the reins. Otherwise, we are going to slide into a recession for everybody. Now, my point of view is that we are going to have a drawn out, not recession, but stagnation. We are not going to see again the rates of growth of we were accustomed to, say, between 1% and 3%. No, we are not going to see those. Calculations and estimation and forecast by the International Monetary Fund and by private banks as well, they are telling us that we will not go back to the level of GDP until 2023, possibly, somebody says, even 2024. So in a world in which there is contraction of incomes, of disposable incomes, and there is an increase in savings, what do you do? As we move on to the next chart, very well, what we see is that this time we have, as I was saying, we have a foreseeable fall in consumption expenditures. We know that the European Central Bank has estimated by the end of 2020, consumption expenditures will be down by 7 to 8%. Now that's a lot. And the reason I'm pestering you with this idea is that I hear a lot of people around saying, well, China is on the move. China's on the move. Expenditures by households have started again in the United States or Norway or wherever, to stay with hyper capita income countries. Be cautious. Expect a drop in consumption expenditures all the way to the end of the second semester of 2012. Now, as we move on, we realize that the next graph, the next chart, very well, Mariuta, tells us that again, we get back there. We go back to the pandemic because this is what people do. People seem stupid, seem to act stupid. go around without face protection, you know, bunching up with friends at a bar. But people are careful, and people do know, do notice that what's happening is that in emerging economy countries, at least, I'm moving on to emerging economies countries now. This is a global perspective I'm using, right? The pandemic is spreading at a growing rate. At a growing rate. So the difference between an epidemic and a pandemic is that the pandemic is something that affects countries worldwide. Well, we are having, look at that curve, you know, the red one, I believe, appropriately, that is China. Sorry, the blue one, appropriately, that is China. You see that in China, the pandemic is under control. It is basically a horizontal line close to the x-axis. But then you see that advanced economies and most of all emerging economies are still in deep trouble. And emerging economies, especially, you know, I'm not going to mention any. Especially, they are everywhere in the press, in the daily press and the weekly press, for you to verify where this is. And what we have here is my problem again. What we have is that there is a bunch of governments that are downplaying this very much, and it doesn't matter if their health officials advise them to the contrary. They are not taking this pandemic very, very carefully. So again, as I was saying early on, interconnecting of health shocks, supply shocks, demand shock, and the effects on demand are devastating. Now, of course, let's go on now. Of course, this is the same chart that I showed earlier for high per capita income countries. Now this is low per capita income countries. Again, the light bar indicates by how much GDP will fall in those countries if we don't have a second run of a second peak of the epidemic, and the dark red one instead will estimate how deep the recession will be if we are going to have a second peak sooner or later. You see that the quantities change, but the picture is basically the same. From this point of view, there is no change between, there's no difference between high per capita income countries and low per capita income countries. We have a few devastating expectations here, like about Turkey and India, towards the end of the chart on the right-hand side. The one about India worries me very much. Remember that the largest number of dead in 1920 was in India. Even though that pandemic was called Spanish, it was nothing Spanish at all. It was called Spanish because a Spanish newspaper published news about it. So it hit low per capita income countries harder. You know, you'll have these charts, you will compare things, and you will see that this is only to be expected. Healthcare systems are not as sophisticated, are not as abundant in many per capita income countries. Living conditions are not as good. We can expect, if we ever have a second wave of the pandemic, we can expect a true disaster. Very well. Now, these countries, remember, also have a problem that a considerable share of their income is made up of remittances from high per capita income countries, right? Citizens leaving their native low per capita income countries go work, and if they're lucky, they find jobs in high per capita income countries. As the per capita income countries' economies shrink dramatically, we are talking about 5 to 10% by the end of this year in Europe, you know, in a rather homogeneous way, Germany, Italy, anywhere. Now, those are the first workers to go. like they're the first workers to go in the oil industry, and so their remittances will dry up, which implies that the shock to households' disposable incomes in low per capita income countries will be particularly dramatic. So, you know, start thinking about where sources of demand are for your firm. Start thinking about what will happen to demand in terms of geographic location, because of course we were going to have two effects. Not only aggregate demand will fall, which we have seen and we are certain it will happen, as it is happening. We also can understand that there is going to be a shift in merchandise composition of demand, right? And a shift in geographical patterns of demand. So this is something that I can't develop today in much detail, but certainly this is something that is going to happen. Demand will not come in the same proportions from the same countries as we had seen before. This graph gives you data about my country, and you know, when I don't want to offend anybody, I take my country as an example. This is the first 4 months of 2020, right? January through April. The rates of economic activity, GDP, have fallen in all major industrial sectors in an unprecedented amount. Now, why do I think it is important to show this graph? Because this is not a sectoral problem. This is not a one industry, two industry, three industry problem. This is all the major industries that we are looking at. And you can see that energy is the one sector that suffered least, so to speak. And of course, energy suffered the least because, you know, thank God we keep having electricity at home and we keep having refrigerators going, and hopefully air conditioning will be going as well. Well, very well. I think this is a pretty nice outlook. Let me sum it up. I'm pretty much within the limits I was assigned. Now, global economic outlook is particularly bleak and uncertain. Sometimes people write to me, you know, over Twitter, over LinkedIn, over anything. They tell me, Prof, aren't you too pessimistic? Well, I say, no. Pessimistic and optimistic is a trait of your personality. It doesn't have any relevance with the analysis you do. And anyway, of course, you hope for the best, but you prepare for the worst. And this is a worst bad enough. Now, implication, therefore, is that demand is difficult to estimate and forecast. We are working on that. We are working on that. I can guarantee that to you. And as I was saying earlier, it is particularly difficult to identify changes in geographical location of demand as well as its merchandise composition. You can come up with any number of examples that you may want. Now, falling disposable income, we talked about that. The second dot in this list talks about unemployment. Now, don't be attracted so much by what newspapers tell you, you know, like unemployment has gone down a lot, it's gone up a lot. When you do structural analysis, when you do theoretical analysis, you know that if income falls and propensity to spend falls, then enterprises, firms, businesses will not have the demand to work on. And few of them can keep working for the shelves and not in the absence of explicit demand. Now, the increase in the number of unemployed, which you may think is big, and it is big, it is still moderate. And it is moderate, why? Because this time, unlike in 2008-2010, governments have adopted immediately income support programs for white collar and blue collar workers. So I'm relatively calm about what's happening over the next month. But remember that in the United States, in July, income support programs will expire. And there is no guarantee that they will be renewed. And for instance, in my country, what we call salaries integration fund, which is a government fund, will expire in July, August. So September may indeed be a very difficult month. Finally, the extension of the pandemic to low per capita income countries. That is particularly bad. That is particularly bad because that's where a lot of goods come from, you know, raw materials, fuels, whatever. We have to be paying attention to them. The World Bank, that's the last dot in my series, the World Bank estimates that the economic repercussions on emerging economies could persist in the coming years. So let me conclude by saying, be optimistic if you wish, if that's what your inclination in life is. Let's hope for the best, all of us, including myself. Let's prepare for the worst. All the analysis we know, everything that has been published by International Monetary Fund, World Bank, but also private research centers and commercial banks, doesn't say anything but demand is going to be weak, unpredictable, both in terms of geographic location and merchandise composition. So it is time to get to work. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sdogati, for this crystal clear global economic outlook. And for all the attendees, if you have questions, please feel free to send us your questions, because we have this 15 minutes session of question and answer. So in the crisis period, the companies have the opportunity to achieve competitive advantage and to differentiate from others. So the question for Mr. Proverbio, how the companies will do?
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Mariuta. Thanks, Fabio. Good evening to everyone. I am an associate of UPS, and I have more than 30 years of experience in supply chain and manufacturing, in large projects, also at European and international level. And so I'm starting from what we have seen in the introduction, in the speech of Fabio, about impact and demand volatility. So I'm talking about new supply chain models that are supporting or can support the business restart model, that are based on agility, on also end-to-end visibility, and looking forward to market potential. And so we will see this in the next page. So we have seen of the great impact on global supply chain, on global economy and global supply chain in terms of demand and supply. So what we have seen in this period of time, we have seen a demand drop, volatility. We have seen anyway also a shortage of products in the stores, medical safety, of course, but also cleaning products and food. We have seen industrial plant closed, but also workers shortage, for instance, in China at the reopenings. Every company probably also had delays in the logistics flows. And we have millions of jobless claims, as we know, for instance, in the US. And many companies already announcing financial crisis, for instance, Hertz is an example, and many others. And in some countries, in China, in Italy, most of the plants and industrial activities reopened, but the demand issue is remaining. As an example, US demand to China in March decreased by 45% versus the previous year, and is expected to further decline in the next period of time, also because of the trade wars, but that is a significantly change in the demand. So we have, as we said, a repeated crisis of demand and supply, because they are happening over a certain period of time in different countries. But it's not only that. There is also a change of consumer preferences, and there is a shift of channel, geographical regions, and products. And so that is also very important. So we, first of all, consumer sentiment that is impacting sales is different by country. In China, is more optimistic. We have 50% that are optimistic. On the other side, we have Japan and European countries such as France and Italy that are more negative, where we have something like in France, as well as in Italy, 40% of people that are pessimistic and only 10-15% that are optimistic, with US in the middle. But what's also important is this optimism decrease in the last week, despite the reopenings. So consumers are expecting long-lasting impact. So there is a geographic shift, probably. On the other side, we have a change in consumer preferences and a products or merchandise shift. We have some winning products that in some cases are sold more than in the past, like groceries, preventive health care, vitamins, household suppliers and entertainment home, and many losing products with impact, very, very strong impact, like cars, consumer electronics, travels and restaurants, but also apparel, footwear, appliances, furnishings. And finally, we have a shift in the channel perspective with a significant increase in digital commerce, in online shopping. For instance, in the US, many product categories increased by more than 30% in the online, like groceries, household suppliers, over-the-counter medicines, fitness and wellness, personal care products. And in March 20 was the first time in US history that consumer bought more groceries online than in the store. Also in Italy and China, we have significantly change and increase in online. For instance, from the company perspective, we have seen that Zara had a significant reduction of sales in this period of time, and that is quite understandable, but in the same time increased by 50% offline and declared to close 1,200 stores, over 7,000 more or less, and to invest millions and millions in the development of online channel with a target of 25%. Campari, the leading beverage and spirit company, was buying Tannico. Tannico is a leading e-commerce platform for wine and premium spirit. Safilo Eyewear bought a few months ago Blenders Highway, that is a US native digital company. So we are really observing a clear trend also from this point of view, an acceleration of the trend of the shift to online shopping. So for sure, we can say that there is an increase of volatility and the fluctuation, peaks and valleys of demand and the shift channel, products and geographic perspective. And so it's becoming more and more difficult to predict the demand and to manage supply chain. Also, that is important for supply chain, we are also observing Forrester or bullwhip effect, that is the increase of swings of demand, so peaks and valleys, moving upstream the supply chain. So there is an amplification of these peaks and valleys, and that is even more important for the B2B company. But it's something that has to be considered. So we can say demand volatility is a new normal and will remain for the next period of time, will remain for the next months and years probably. And so considering that we have this demand volatility and also the shift in channel, geographic products, so we'll have also potential financial failures of companies and suppliers, for instance, my suppliers, the suppliers of my company. Managing a global supply chain will become more and more difficult. But on the other side, more and more important to support business restart in terms of ensure product availability, service level, and even total cost optimization. So we have an opportunity for the company, and working on rethinking their supply chain model, they can establish a competitive advantage and become leaders versus and differentiating themselves from the laggards. It's an opportunity, but it's also a risk if you are not taking this opportunity. And of course, this pandemic is one of the possible risk events impacting global supply chain. We have trade wars, Brexit, of course, the financial failures, natural disaster, political, social, and security risks. And what also is important is, according to a global survey by Institute for Supply Chain in March this year, 75% of the companies had disruption with negative impact. And that is quite understandable considering this crisis. But 44% didn't have a plan for that, didn't have a mitigation plan. And that is quite impressive and is something that companies can't afford to have also in the next years, that anyway will be turbulent. So how supply chain can support and stimulate business restart, ensuring business continuity, ensuring product availability, and ensuring also the different channels. We have two sets of capabilities that we believe are really important to develop and to work on. One is supply chain risk management. So really to have a culture and capabilities of supply chain risk management in terms of risk identification, evaluation, mitigation plans, really, and not reactive. So when we have a problem, but proactive mitigation plans. A clear responsibility over risk management, and also more important is a real-time incidence monitoring in order to be able to catch, to identify the problems in real time and to manage it. From the other side, we have supply chain agility and digital, and what is consisting in that? So we need to have fast reaction to unplanned events. So short lead times, demand change, and I have to be able to react quickly. So I need a multi-regional footprint. So we need also to have not very distant suppliers, if it's possible, and not depending on a single supply market that is very risky. I need end-to-end visibility. End-to-end visibility means also to my suppliers, but also to the second level, third level of suppliers, and the same on the customer side. I have to know where my suppliers is producing and where are the plant of the second level suppliers. Maybe in I have a supplier in Germany, but then materials are coming from China or are coming from another country. I need to know, because only in this way I can have a control, I can anticipate the problems, otherwise I can't. So that is strictly connected with risk management that we have seen before. And also we need something to control the extended supply chain, so a supply chain control tower. Another important capability, this is changing the paradigm, is what we call zero-based demand planning. So the typical demand planning logic and algorithm based on historical series, historical orders, are not proper in this period of time. They are not representing the future, and they have to be changed. So we need an approach, clean sheet, zero-based, that is looking at the final demand anyway and the market potential, and we will see in the next page. Then also collaboration with customers and suppliers and partners is very important, because only in this way I can achieve visibility, first of all. I can achieve also a faster reaction, and finally the digital technologies, for instance automation is very important, but also the possibility to take data, to big data, analytics, augmented reality, and that is also important capability. We also have developed a kind of assessment about supply chain resilience of a company, named Supply Chain Resilience Assessment. Is based on a list of questions. We have more than 50 questions on the bull supply chain, from customer to suppliers to network. And that are only an example of this question. I don't want to have the full list, but for instance, we have, do you know your supplier structure, second and third level, and the lead times and the logistic flow from that? How many components are in single sourcing or depends on a single supplier market? If you know the production capacity, stock, order status of your suppliers, if you have a risk management, if you have a risk map with evaluation, on the other side, if you have a demand plans that are based, if they are based on historical orders, or you are using external sources of information, such as consumer sentiment, macroeconomic variables that are more proper in this period of time. And how is your manufacturing network? If it's global, multi-regional, regional, multi-local, local. So that are a series of questions that is allowing to map the maturity and the resilience level of your supply chain, comparing with best practices, with the identification of the critical areas. In this map, you see that we have the resilience level from 1 to 6, and we have different axes, and you can map your supply chain resilience against these axes. So visibility, supplier structure, in terms of geographical distribution, sourcing logic, so single versus multiple sourcing, supplier collaboration, risk management, risk manager, demand distribution and splitting, planning, network, manufacturing network, customer collaboration, governance of the supply chain. And in this way, we can identify the red areas, so the areas of low resilience on which you have to work on. To map your overall situation of supply chain, you have a reactive basic supply chain, or you are going to an agile model, and to identify the improvement areas. So we can see some of the pillars on which this agile model is based on. And so we said, first of all, supply chain risk management. As a prerequisite, we said extended visibility, knowledge of where, for instance, my first and second level suppliers are and produce. It's also important to highlight, as a second, according to a recent survey by Resilink, 70% of the company don't know their multi-level supplier network. That is important because it's important to fill this gap, if you have this gap, because otherwise it's difficult really to have a consistent supply chain risk management approach and to increase your resilience. So which are the steps for a supply chain, effective supply chain risk management approach? You have to extend the visibility. You have to identification and evaluation of the risks. The risks, of course, are all the kind of risks that we have seen before that are impacting anyway your customer, your demand, your suppliers, your manufacturing and logistics nodes, your IT. You need to have mitigation plans, reactive and proactive. And you have to identify then the risk, so a geographical risk mapping using a source of information, typically external source of information, and to have a real-time monitoring of events and structural actions. We have different solutions of this type that can support this kind of risk management. For instance, we have a cloud service of GeoRisk Map by TD Square that is monitoring geographical, political, economical, operational safety risks to identify supplier and customer in critical areas, but also to support the multi-level network mapping in a collaborative approach. Then another capability that we mentioned is the zero-based demand planning that is part of a wider sales profit and operations planning. What means zero-based demand planning? So we need an approach that is forward-looking to market potential, to the final demand, not the typical, for many companies, sell-in forecasting based on historical series. It's data-driven, so we need information from multiple external data sources. Macroeconomic and other factors are key, for instance, GDP, consumer confidence index, unemployment level, but also urban and highway traffic are, in some cases, useful information. For sure, I have to identify which variables are impacting my business the most important. And I have to monitor these variables also in the future. Another is the voice of the customers. So it's a point of view directly from the customer, possibly final customers, so with panels of experts, of consumers. And in the short period of time, it's also important to have real-time demand signals, so to have every signal that is highlighting variations and unplanned variation of my demand. In order to be able to analyze and to react as short as is possible. Another important approach, another important characteristics of this planning process is that must be collaborative with customer and supplier, but also within company. So we need a strong involvement of different functions within the company and at the top management level. And must be business and profit driven. So I need also to take actions in order to support sales and profit growth. It's not only matching demand in quantities with supply, but also I have to analyze the overall sales and demand value and the profit, and eventually to differentiated all the supply based on the profit, different profitability of the products, for instance. And also important to have, for, of course, the involvement of finance and the integration with the budgeting process. Last different important element is a frequency. Must be a dynamic planning. The typical monthly process of many sales and operations planning process is too slow for these turbulent times. We need a bigger frequency, at least a weekly review of demand, as well as real-time signals. Okay. In examples, we have a large retailer that is using macroeconomic variables for his demand planning, for his sales planning. And of course, we have in this area macroeconomics variables that are the first starting point for the overall volumes of demand. They are using, for instance, GDP, consumer price index, gas price, unemployment, consumer confidence index, inflation rate, and manufacturing price index. Of course, they are also using seasonality, weather conditions, competition actions, customer profiles, store profiles, but then to differentiate and to enter in to split the demand. But the overall is starting from these macroeconomic variables, and they are through statistical approach. They are determining the most important, the most influencing variable for my model. And in this way, they increased forecast accuracy, improving product availability and service level. That is an example of what can be done on demand planning side. Another important capability is the Global Supply Chain Control Tower. What is it? It's a service center, value-added planning hub with a team of people, supply chain experts, planners, data scientists, that is important, supporting decision making. So they are decision makers, and they are also planning based on the data that are coming from all the different nodes and sources of information with a set of capabilities. One of these capabilities clear is the data, real-time data gathering and ingestions from, of course, my systems, from my supply chain node, but also from external data sources. Examples are IHS Markit that is producing the information about many of these macroeconomics indicators and the risks in the different countries, Bloomberg, social media. I need to have a big data management capability, and then visibility analytics and advanced analytics, including risk and demand scenarios. Implementing or doing a global supply chain control tower requires new capabilities, as we have seen, and as organizational impact, it requires new roles, responsibility, and professional profiles. And for, of course, also an application, a platform, typically with IoT, cloud, big data, artificial intelligence technologies. We have several examples, anyway, of control tower, of planning hub. For instance, we have a global pharma company that achieved this extended visibility over the supply chain, its own supply chain, but also supplier, contract manufacturer, customer, until pharmacies, allowing a fast and effective reaction to disruption event that is very important in this period of time, including also new acquisition. And this kind of control tower also stimulating the collaborative approach along the ecosystem with the different partners. In other examples, we have a planning hub built by a multinational consumer company that increase the frequency of the planning processes with daily alerts coming from the different nodes. We do 200 types of alerts with a predefined solution protocol for each type. Examples of this type of alerts are change of demand, variation of significant variation of demand, trend and in the launch of new products. So what's happening if the new products are going as planned or not, stockout situation, delays from suppliers, and so on. So we have many types of these alerts. It's important to have these alerts and to react in the shorter period of time. And in fact, they accelerated the monthly process to a weekly process, reacting within 48 hours to variation of demand and supply within these types of alerts. Of course, considering what was possible to do in this period of time. Then we were also talking about speed, about network. So we need also a network that is overall a supply chain that is short, with a short lead time. So everything must be close to demand. So we need probably a multi-regional network with a flexible and reprogrammable network of plants. The manufacturing and logistics network is not only based on labor cost arbitrage and efficiency, but has to consider the capability to react to unplanned events. And I would say a total cost approach, but a total cost approach in which we are considering material cost and energy cost and labor cost, but we have also to consider logistics, transportation cost in case of urgency. What happens if my demand is changing and I have lead times of months? I have a cost, loss of opportunity, and I have to quantify this disruption cost. That has to be considered in the simulation and the total cost approach, as well as obsolescence cost, of course. And this network has to be periodically reviewed because the condition is changing based on this total cost approach and so resilience to risk factors. Finally, must also be customer driven. I need to differentiate my service policies based, for instance, on customers, but also based on channels. We've seen that there is the increase of digital channels. I have to respond in a different way to digital channels. This customer, this consumer, have a different request. My supply chain has to be able to manage that. And also must be able to support additional, for instance, after sales services to customers, like Total Care, but also UMI, and so on. Last, my supply chain also has to leverage, in many cases, digital technologies. So we see an examples of many possible cases over my supply chain. We see the technology, we see the different typical process of supply chain, procurement, plan, make, fulfill, and the customer service. And we have many examples. For instance, in red, you see about the make. About the make, I can have workers in the factory that are using tablets or are using other devices, totem, that are supporting the elimination of paper, the reduction of manual activities. Also the virtual collaboration, for instance, between R&D and plant for the launch of new products that is typically a problem of industrialization and that can be effective for reducing the timing of launching of new products, as well as the tracking of labor and materials and the digital work instruction that is allowing to have a reduction of manual activities to reduce the errors in activities. Another important application here to the right is the product visualization enabled by augmented reality in 3D, for instance, for the digital commerce of a retailer. In this case, we have some app in the consumer can have really a visualization in of the products as it was in the same environment, in the same room. And that is typically able to increase what is called the conversion rate, the conversion rate from the contact to the buying, and also to have a decrease in the returns because the consumer have seen really the problem. That is an important, for instance, enablement for retailer and for digital commerce. Another possibility is all the remote diagnostics of machines, of complex products, that again is reducing the time to fix the problem, is reducing the cost, and is also allowing to have new additional services and after sales services. An agile supply chain model can have can introduce benefits and a significantly number of benefits. We have we said that demand planning accuracy, of course, will not be easy to as we have seen to forecast to plan the demand. But with the approach of the zero-based demand planning, as well as voice of the customer, demand signals, I can anyway improve versus the historical sell-in approach and to have much more accuracy in from this side. That is allowing to improve service level, product availability, on-time delivery, and even more important, to reduce revenues at risks. And then there is the possibility to reduction of obsolescence cost, disruption cost, and to have, as we have seen in the digital and automation, efficiency. Finally, to support new streams of revenues in terms of new channels, for instance, and new services. So an agile supply chain can really boost, give a boost and stimulating the business restart. So the sum up of the actions that we have seen, actions, so visibility of the supply, extending supply chain risk management, zero-based demand planning, my dynamic and data-driven sales profit and operation planning, supply chain control tower, sourcing review approach, omni-channel strategy implementation, for instance, the development of online commerce and augmented reality 3D visualization, digital supply chain technologies, servitization and proactive after-sales services, supply chain and manufacturing network review, applying the total cost approach. What is also important to say is that anyway we need a split of actions for the identified action that are some of these actions. Is it's not possible to wait for years in a project, but we need something that is done in months. So we need actions over a reduced time frame, not years and years projects. And so what are the principles of this business restart? That what we have seen in demand volatility is a new normal. This demand volatility, this turbulent time requires strong risk management and end-to-end visibility. I need to know to be able to manage the risks. Acceleration of the digital adoption, and the economists say that in 5 years, will be compressed in 18 months. And I believe it's really true. New agile supply chain models based on the principle that we have seen, and in particular, zero-based demand planning. Restarting from people will be Even more important in this context in which remote working and digitalization are even more important. So involvement, delegation, leadership, talent management will be even more important. And finally, servitization, because the development of services can add additional services and can boost business restart, and speed of action. So you don't have years, you have a shorter period of time for implementing some of these actions and for differentiated from the other companies.
Thank you very much, Mr. Proverbio. And thank you for this magic formula regarding the supply chain restart. So for the attendees, please send us your questions because you'll have soon a session of questions and answers. So, what happened in this moment? So, and how Tesi Square responds to the market in this moment? So, Tesi Square offering model supports development of new processes with smart offering. How will do it? So, in this way, with a standard solution based on pre-built processes and ready to use. In the same time, we encourage this collaboration so among supply chain partners by multi-enterprise collaboration platforms, covers various supply chain processes, and in the same time allows to adopt a risk-based approach, including the mapping of the geo-risk. So exactly what also Mr. Proverbio shared with us during his presentations. Last but not least, the smart offering provided by Tesi Square allows a fast and economic with an economic impact and with a high return of investment. So all the above mentioned smart offering will provide to our companies the possibility to increase the level of digitization and the visibility. So, very important to share with you that Tesi Square, together its ecosystem partners, supports the companies in a pragmatic way during the changing process with smart and fast services covering three important areas. So, advisory business service, smart application, and last but not least, supply chain finance. So we'll have the possibility to share more information about Tesi Square offering. Therefore, please feel free to contact us and you'll have the possibility to have more information about our portfolio. So we have now a session of question and answers. And so we'll try to have all the questions for you. Okay, Mr. Sbogati.
I'm ready, shoot.
Perfect. So this the first question is for you. So about consumer goods. Do you think you can talk shortly about what countries, region of the world will recover faster in terms of the demand?
Well, my answer is straightforward, China. And the reason I say China is going to be the first, is going to be the country where demand will start first, is because in my model that I called the intertwining of health shocks, demand shocks, and supply shocks, China was the first one to be hit, and it had begun to getting out of the crisis, even though, as we can see, not even China is immune to recurring attacks by the coronavirus. Now, the International Monetary Fund forecasts that possibly China and Vietnam will be the two only countries in the world not witnessing a degrowth in even 2020. And they are also going to lead the pack in 2021. So in 2020, GDP will fall everywhere by very much, but in Vietnam and China. And then in 2021, the recovery will be fastest in China and then in India and in Vietnam. So my guess is that it is time, as it was 20 years ago, to start thinking about China as a market. I remember two decades ago, even more than that, 25 years ago, we at my school began advising firms that it was time to start thinking of China as a consumer, not just as a cheap labor producer. And I don't think we were being listened very much back then, while the United States and Germany were paying attention to both sides of the story, China as a production side, but also as a demand side. I think that now it is the time to start working on this very much. And I'm not talking just about the textile and clothing or even the luxury people, the luxury goods. You know, sometimes one hears that the luxury market will benefit very much from the love for luxury that the Chinese have. I have no reason to disbelieve that. I believe it, but that's not only for luxury. In China, demand for goods, for consumer goods in general, will be growing fast. And so it will in Vietnam. Vietnam is a country that is not often paid a lot of attention to, but Vietnam is a very young country. Average age is ridiculously low. They love anything that is Western. And they are ready to spend a lot of money on consumption goods along with structural goods. So to me, Asia, revolving around China, Vietnam, and then South Korea, and then slowly Southeast Asia. Then the second area will probably be the European countries, and the reason for that is that this time both central bank and governments have reacted very vigorously against this pandemic in economic terms, and so I expect there to be some growth. About the United States, I would like not to take a stand, because I mean it is a very difficult situation in the United States. One of the reasons is that they are going to have these elections in November, and you know, November is what, 5 months away, eh? Not much. So we don't really know how that all is going to play, even though I expect the US will keep playing the role of consumer of last resort for the world economy for a while still. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sdogati. A question, a very interesting question for Mr. Proverbio. Which is the timing and the approach for doing a supply chain resilience assessment? Which is the timing for implementing some of the most urgent actions?
Yes, thanks. About the first, the assessment has to be done very, very quickly. The approach is an approach that is very lean and is based on some questions. So it's typically in 2, 3, 4 weeks, depending, of course, of the complex of the complexity, and also depending on the overall scope, geographical scope, if we are talking about an Italian, European, a global company. About the implementation phase, as we said before, of some of the actions, the most urgent and the one that can have introduced real benefits, we have to work we are talking in months and not in years. We can't afford to have a multi-year projects, we need to have actions that are taking months with an approach business driven, of course, but that also is using also standard solution for acceleration.
Thank you, Mr. Proverbio. We receive a lot of questions, interesting questions. Hope to have enough time during these minutes. So, a question for Mr. Sdogati. So, do you think that the household income support programs adopted by several governments will be sufficient to hold private demand steady?
Okay, I'll try and be very brief so to give room to as many questions as possible. One,
thank you.
Unlike 2007, 2010, this time governments have intervened very, very quickly. Even the Italians, they intervened very, very quickly to support private income. Now, that's a very good thing. The second feature this time is that central banks, even the European Central Bank, intervened very quickly and massively to make sure that the system would have the liquidity to keep functioning. And they are even discussing more financing or guarantees, at least, for firms over the coming few months. Of course, the economies that are going to be hit worst if consumer support programs, household support programs, income support programs are going to be cut over the summer are the countries where GDP is driven by consumption. Now, that's particularly the United States, which have defined the consumer of last resort just a minute ago. Demand will be steady, but very low. Demand will be falling for at least another 6 months. It will be shifting, as my colleague Proverbio was saying a short while ago, it will be shifting distribution channels in chain, merchandises will be changing. And so while in the aggregate, demand may stay stable, low, but stable in 2021, there's going to be a lot of sectoral shifts most likely.
Thank you, Mr. Sdogati. The last question for Mr. Proverbio. So we talk about timing, now a question regarding the cost. So the network redesign to increase resilience and risk mitigation is introducing additional cost?
Yes, good questions. I need a real total cost approach. A real total cost approach means to consider really all the costs that are impacting my network, my supply chain. This cost is not only, of course, material, labor, energy, and so on, but they are considering logistics cost, but also obsolescence and disruption or revenues at risk cost, because if for instance I have a very very distant suppliers with months of reaction, and I have it is happening now, as it will happen in the next months, I have a change of demand and I need to react. If my lead times are 3 months, I can't react, and I am losing a lot of opportunities. And that is something that has to be considered, as well as disruption costs. So what's happening if I am depending on distant suppliers that can have a problem also in this case. So my answer is no, but I need have to introduce a real total cost approach.
Thank you, Mr. Proverbio. So we arrive at the end of this session, and I propose to you to end on an optimistic note. It's said that the worst of time brings out the best in people. As it happens, this is true of the organization as well. People are energized as companies make good on their purpose statements and find new ways to serve their customer and communities. So let's hope this continues well beyond the pandemic. And thank you to my guests, Mr. Sdogati and Mr. Proverbio, and all the attendees. Thank you. Have a nice evening.
Thank you all.
Thanks very much.
Good evening. Thank you.